The most recent ice age ended a few thousand years ago, and today the world is, according to geological definitions, in a warm phase of an interglacial period. Some experts even suggest that we might be heading towards another ice age. The relative positions of the Earth and the Sun are similar to those of 116,000 years ago, when the interglacial period that preceded the last ice advance was ending. It's not out of the question that history could repeat itself, and within 5,000 years, glaciers might once again cover vast continental areas. Other scientists are even more pessimistic, hypothesizing that an ice age could start within the next 2 to 3 centuries as a consequence of global warming and climate change. The rise in atmospheric temperatures could lead to such massive precipitation at mid to high latitudes that it could dilute the Gulf Stream, which originates in the tropics, travels towards the poles, sinks in the North Atlantic, and returns to the tropics by flowing along the ocean floor, a 2,500-year cycle, reducing its salinity. If this were to happen, the oceanic river would be disrupted, ceasing the flow of heat from the tropics. Some researchers estimate that an annual increase of just 1% in atmospheric CO2 could be enough to halt the Gulf Stream within a century. Consequently, ice would begin to expand further south, eventually engulfing major cities like London and New York. Is this our future? Are we headed for another ice age? And if so, what will trigger it? We don't know for sure if things will unfold this way, but we can look at what happened in the distant past. For example, we know that in the last 2 million years, there was at least one point when the most advanced ice sheets descended to 100 meters above sea level, perpetual snow started 1,400 meters lower than today, and the ocean surface was 120 meters below current levels. At intermediate latitudes below 500 meters, glaciers gave way to steppes that covered much of the European continent. The landscape was barren, and forests did not extend beyond North Africa and the Middle East. But how do we know all of this? After all, there were no thermometers back then. Well, evidence of past ice ages comes from geology. Ice ages were first thoroughly studied in Central Europe, especially along some rivers that flow into the Danube, which were named after the various glaciations. Today, there's no longer any doubt that there have been ice ages on our planet. But the first person to talk about them, Swiss scientist Louis Agassiz in the mid-19th century, was met with ridicule from his fellow scientists. Definitive evidence only emerged many years later, when geologists began finding clues left behind by ancient ice sheets. Geologists realized that glaciers could leave scars on the bedrock through the abrasion of small rocks carried by their flow and compressed by their weight. It was also discovered that they were and still are capable of transporting boulders and incoherent granular material from places far away from their origin. The result is the formation of frontal or lateral hills made of this material, called moraines, or the presence of large solidarity boulders transported and deposited on plains, or even in the open sea, known as erratic boulders. Thanks to valuable information derived from abraded rocks, erratic boulders both on land and in the sea, and moraine material, coupled with the study of continental drift in the past, geologists have managed to identify these ancient ice ages and glacial activity during those periods, including estimating their intensity by calculating the extent of the ice sheets towards the equator. It was thus discovered that the oldest known ice age began around 1.5 million years ago, possibly preceded by an even older one, and was named Danau, while the most recent one, ending approximately 10,500 years ago, was called Worm. The latter appears to have been the coldest, with an average temperature about 10 degrees Celsius lower than today. Other glaciations were classified as Gunns, Mindel, and Riss. There is no uniformity in these phenomena, neither in duration, extent, nor average temperature. Danau, for example, affected the Alps for almost 500,000 years, while Worm lasted no more than 65,000 years. Moreover, there were warm intervals with extended periods of glacier retreat, which is why there are references to interglacial periods within the ice ages themselves. This is primarily why the European classification is no longer used today, and the concept of phase has been introduced instead, referring to a period of glacier expansion or retreat in certain geographic areas. Further confirmation of ice ages comes from ice cores extracted into Antarctica and Greenland, whose study has allowed climate reconstruction dating back up to 400,000 years. This has been made possible through the analysis of oxygen trapped in air bubbles in the ice layers. There exists an oxygen isotope, a variation of it with 10 neutrons instead of 8, which is more abundant in the ocean during cold periods because normal oxygen is lighter and evaporates more. When it's cold, the evaporated water partly forms ice, enriching the ocean with the heavier isotope. Oxygen atoms are then absorbed by the organisms that make up the plankton, such as foraminifera, and used to create their shells. Some of these shells, preserved in sediments as fossils, have allowed researchers to deduce the concentration of oxygen isotopes and consequently the average temperature of that period, confirming the alternation of warm and cold periods. Furthermore, there are traces left by humans themselves, for example from rock paintings such as those in Lascaux and Chauvet in France, or Altamira in Spain. It has been possible to discover that the rhinoceros Colodonta antiquantis was covered in thick fur. Additionally, the ongoing melting of ice in Siberia continues to reveal surprises from the past, such as the perfectly preserved woolly rhinoceros that resurfaced at the end of 2020. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. There are also traces of glaciations even older than those we've discussed. The oldest is believed to have occurred between 2.5 and 2 billion years ago, possibly triggered by the emergence of photosynthesis in early organisms. The removal of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere reduced the greenhouse effect, and the emission of oxygen, which combined to form ozone in the upper atmosphere, created a shield against incoming solar energy. These factors cooled the planet, leading to the formation of polar ice caps that spread rapidly over large areas of Earth. The primary evidence of this ancient glaciation can be observed near Lake Huron between Canada and the United States, in a sequence of rock layers known as the Golgonda Formation. These are lacustrine sediments generated by glacial meltwater. During the summer, when glacial melt is most pronounced, the greater volume of water transports coarser materials compared to the autumn. In winter, with reduced glacial melt, the deposition ceases. This sequence is typically well-defined and so precise that, for example, it has been possible to calculate that the end of the last glaciation in Sweden began exactly 10,182 years ago. Cold periods, varying in intensity, have occurred from the Paleozoic era to the present day. However, one of the most significant could be considered the mother of all glaciations, the one that occurred between 700 and 600 million years ago, when Earth essentially became a snowball and remained so for about 10 million years. In that era, the land masses were small and concentrated near the equator. This caused massive evaporation of water from the seas, and when it precipitated as rain, it removed large amounts of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. The natural greenhouse effect decreased to the point of initiating the formation of polar ice caps. The heat from the Earth's core prevented the complete freezing of the oceans, but an average temperature of minus 50 degrees Celsius caused the ice covering the polar regions to reach a thickness of up to 1 kilometer. In these conditions, life struggling to emerge on Earth was at serious risk of extinction. Science fiction? Not at all. The Snowball Earth hypothesis is one of the most intriguing scientific theories developed to explain some anomalies observed by geologists in rocks around the world. For instance, there's the presence of glacial debris embedded in deposits that were once at sea level, and furthermore located near the equator. There's also the discovery of iron-rich sediments, which can only be explained by a total absence of oxygen in the atmosphere. As if that weren't enough, such an intense glaciation should have triggered a vicious cycle. More ice doesn't just mean more cold, but also a higher surface albedo, capable of reflecting more solar radiation back into space, leading to even colder temperatures. At that point, it seemed like Earth would never break free from this icy grip, and life would be wiped out in its infancy. However, during that era, as was later discovered, very primitive life forms like algae, cyanobacteria, and phytoplankton continued to survive and reproduce in the shelter of volcanic hot springs. The volcanoes themselves turned out to be our saviors. On the Snowball Earth, there was no more rain. Liquid water only remained in the deep ocean beneath the ice. It couldn't evaporate, and clouds couldn't form. Meanwhile, the volcanoes continued to release their gases, including carbon dioxide and methane, the main culprits of the greenhouse effect. These gases couldn't be washed away by rainfall. It took from 4 to 30 million years, but by the end of this period, the concentration of greenhouse gases increased 1,000-fold. The ice melted, atmospheric moisture returned, free water absorbed heat from the sun, and Earth transformed into an oasis where average temperatures were 50 degrees above zero. In the meantime, continents shifted. This may have prevented a return to the worst ice age ever. Now though, the final question arises, the million-dollar question. How long until the next glaciation? Can we calculate even approximately the time we have left to live in a relatively favorable climate like today's? Answering this question would mean discovering the true cause of glaciations, and thus the algorithm that could enable us to predict the onset and severity of temperature drops. This was partially achieved in the early 20th century by the Siberian mathematician Milutin Milankovitch, who, through his studies, was convinced that the entire cycle of the great glaciations of the past million years could be described by considering that the Sun, Earth, and the other planets are not perfect billiard balls moving in constant orbits and spinning in the same old way. Everything changes in the universe. Everything is in constant flux. In particular, the Earth's orbit is currently almost circular, with an eccentricity of about 0.0167. However, that almost means that the difference between aphelion and perihelion is about 5 million kilometers. Not only that, in a cycle of around 92,000 years, the eccentricity of Earth's orbit can vary up to a value of 0.058 due to gravitational attractions with other planets, resulting in a difference between aphelion and perihelion that can reach up to 17 million kilometers. The inclination of the axis of rotation in the plane of the ecliptic, which is currently at 23.4 degrees, oscillates from 22.5 to 24.5 degrees over approximately 41,000 years. The third significant variation is the orientation of the axis, caused by the so-called precession of the equinoxes, where the line of the equinoxes shifts over time in a clockwise direction, completing a full 360-degree rotation in about 25,800 years. As a result, the Earth assumes opposite inclinations every approximately 12,900 years in relation to the direction of fixed stars. These astronomical cycles influence the amount of solar energy that reaches the Earth in different seasons and at various latitudes. For instance, when the Earth's axis is more inclined, the temperature differences between seasons are more pronounced, while a less inclined axis results in more uniform seasons. Additionally, orbital eccentricity determines variations in the total amount of solar energy that the Earth receives throughout the year. The combined effects of these cycles can lead to significant changes in Earth's climate. When these variations are synchronized in a way that solar energy is concentrated in the northern hemisphere during the summer months, warmer periods known as interglacial periods can occur, during which glaciers retreat and sea levels rise. Conversely, when the variations lead to reduced solar energy in northern regions, glacial periods with extensive ice coverage and lower sea levels can occur. It is crucial to understand that the alternation of glacial and interglacial periods is driven by seemingly minor temperature variations. Consider that the average temperature during a glacial period is only 4 to 6 degrees Celsius lower than the average temperature during an interglacial period. The connection between Milankovitch cycles and Earth's climate has been demonstrated through the analysis of climate data and geological evidence. So it appears that we have already found the answer we were seeking. In fact, if the sole cause of glaciations were the astronomical circumstances suggested by Milankovitch, it would be relatively easy to establish that the alternation of cold-warm cycles should repeat approximately every 40,000 years. This would lead us to believe that the time to change our winter wardrobe is fast approaching. Unfortunately, things become considerably more complicated when considering the influence of non-astronomical factors that are difficult to quantify. There is a general consensus that the occurrence of an ice age is also influenced by the composition of the atmosphere, which plays a crucial role in retaining or eliminating carbon dioxide, nitrogen oxides, and other elements emitted by volcanic eruptions, gases that either enhance or reduce the greenhouse effect. And above all, it depends on the movements of tectonic plates, which determine the positions of continents on the Earth's surface. The shifts of continental plates can alter ocean currents, leading to global climate variations. For instance, the presence of land within the Arctic or Antarctic polar circles provides an area where snow and ice can accumulate during cold periods. The resulting white ice cover increases the Earth's albedo, which, as we mentioned earlier, reflects more solar radiation back into space, contributing to further cooling. So in the end, the answer to the question is that the combination of measurable factors and random event, such as the impact of large asteroids capable of obscuring the atmosphere with their dust for years, makes it virtually impossible to determine with precision when the Earth's climate will begin to shift towards a small or large glaciation. To understand how challenging it is to make predictions in this regard, one need only review the capricious climate variations that marked the course of European history over the last centuries. From the 9th to the 13th century, the medieval warm period was characterized by a stable climate and temperatures 2 degrees Celsius higher than today's. Favorable climate conditions allowed grape cultivation in Norway. Viking settlers in Greenland cultivated wheat for over 300 years. With modern technology, Greenland managed to grow wheat for only 1 year. The snow line in the Alps rose by 200 to 300 meters. Thanks to increased arable land, Europe's population quadrupled during this period. From the 14th to the 19th century, known as the Little Ice Age, glaciers advanced across Europe. Scholars have identified two phases of minimum temperatures, known as the Sporer Minimum, 1300 to 1550, and the Maunder Minimum, 1650 to 1800. The cold and unstable climate led to famines and the spread of epidemics, with the most devastating being the Black Plague in the mid-14th century. From 1310 to 1322, there were severe winters and cold summers. The winter of 1317-1318 was exceptionally harsh, with snowfall in Cologne on June 30th. After a brief respite in the second half of the 14th century, the cold climate persisted throughout the 15th century. The century began with the severe winter of 1408 and 1409, one of the coldest of the millennium, along with that of 1708-1709. During this winter, the Thames River froze for 3 months, and polar ice reached Scotland. Another mild period occurred between 1530 and 1560. The summer of 1540 was the hottest in Europe in the last 40,000 years. Switzerland experienced temperatures 5 degrees Celsius above current averages. Drought cracked the earth, and people were dying in the streets from heat stroke. Then the cold returned, affecting Europe until the early 19th century. In 1658, a cold wave froze the Danish Straits, and the Swedish army invaded Denmark, marching, cavalry, and artillery included on the ice. The winter of 1708-1709 was terribly cold, much like that of 1408-1409. In January 1709, polar temperatures were recorded in Europe. Paris reached minus 23 degrees Celsius, Berlin minus 29, and Venice minus 17.5. The Venetian Lagoon froze, as did the surface of Lake Garda. The coldest period occurred between 1783 and 1816, largely due to intense volcanic activity, leading to 1816 being called the year without a summer. From 1850, there was a gradual warming trend, although it was slowed by a small solar minimum in the late 19th century, Damen minimum, and cooling between approximately 1940 and 1970. In particular, the winters from 1939 to 1947 were extremely cold. From the 1970s and 80s onwards, global warming resumed, leading to the modern warm period that we are all currently experiencing. In short, understanding these phenomena is not easy, and in the face of these disruptions, which occurred in centuries when human activity couldn't have had any influence on the climate, it's reasonable to have doubts about the cause of the current period of global warming. In practice, to learn more, we can only wait. Still, it will undoubtedly be a problem that concerns our future descendants.